This is Michael Matheson Miller, and you are listening to the Moral Imagination Podcast. Thank you again for listening to the Moral Imagination Podcast. My guest today is Dr. David Diebel, and we're going to talk about the book he co-edited with Jessica Houghton Wilson called Solzhenitsyn and American Culture, The Russian Soul in the West. So we don't just discuss Solzhenitsyn, but many of the themes that he talks about that apply to our contemporary life, including a critique of materialism, the attraction to modern Stoicism, and how Stoicism can sometimes become infected with utilitarianism and narcissism. We also talk about the affirmation of being, the goodness of being, and how this connects to the ideas of human suffering, but also redemption. We discuss a number of essays in the book, including one about the role of Russian literature and the Russian experience and how this relates to contemporary American life and politics, including the tension between globalism and nationalism, consumerism, and so on. Here, there's some overlap with Chris Arnotti's book, Dignity, and so you can listen to my podcast with Chris at themoralimagination.com. And toward the end of the discussion, we talk about atheism and morality, and then one of the problems that Solzhenitsyn identified that we're often embarrassed to talk about categories of good or evil or truth, but that if we want to take injustice and political and social evil seriously, we have to deal with the human person and with the idea of conscience. So a lot of discussion here. I hope you enjoy the podcast. Thank you again for listening. Thanks for the kind reviews and for those who support the podcast on Patreon. You can get all the show notes, links to books, links to Patreon and other resources at themoralimagination.com. So thanks again, and I hope you enjoy my podcast with Dr. David Diebel on Solzhenitsyn and American culture. All right, thanks, Dave, for joining the podcast.
Hey, I'm glad to be with you, Michael.
Thanks. So I want to talk about your book, Solzhenitsyn and American Culture, The Russian Soul and the West. And this is an edited collection that you did with Jessica
Houghton Wilson, yes.
Jessica Houghton Wilson. Okay, great. And so obviously the book has a lot of different essays in it, and we won't get to all of it. So I want to talk about a couple of key ones, including your essay. But why don't we start, before getting into some of the details, why another book on Solzhenitsyn? And then why Solzhenitsyn and American culture? Why do you think this book matters? And why do you think Solzhenitsyn matters?
Yeah, well, this book has a very particular history. My mentor in college, Edward Erickson Jr., was one of the foremost authorities on Solzhenitsyn. He worked directly with Solzhenitsyn to provide a one-volume Gulag Archipelago, only about 450 pages rather than the 1,800 to 2,000 pages. And when Ed died in 2017, I was actually quite sad. And I talked to Jessica Wilson, who was then at John Brown University. She's a phenomenal English scholar who's done a lot of work on Flannery O'Connor and Walker Percy, and particularly their connections to Russian writers. And she had also been mentored by Ed through her connections with Russian literature. And we talked about doing something that would not only honor Ed, but also continue his work of bringing Solzhenitsyn to bear on our conversation today. And what we thought was, Ed was a fantastic American patriot. He was a Chicago boy, evangelical, raised in Chicago, studied at the University of Arkansas, loved America, but he also thought that there were great problems with America. And he saw in the Russian writers, particularly in the 70s, those dissenting writers, something that struck him, that they have an answer to some of our problems because their problems aren't so different from ours. And so we wanted to put together a volume that would bring together different writers who would connect the Russian tradition, literary, political, religious, and cultural, to America, and not only open up Solzhenitsyn and some other Russian writers, but also figure out how it is that we can think about our own situation today in light of the Russian experience.
So I think the first thing, that's very interesting, that whole story of how it comes up. But the first thing is, I think many people would be surprised to say that Russia, especially in the 70s during the Cold War, and perhaps today, what did they have to say to America in contemporary times, but also at that time? I mean, I think they'd be maybe surprised or skeptical to say that Russia under Soviet totalitarianism has much to say to America.
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously not everybody in Russia had something to say, but those who saw the problems with Soviet totalitarianism, with Marxist-Leninism, saw in the West and in America, they saw a great promise. They thought that Solzhenitsyn, for instance, was a great fan of the American founding, but he said that you're not actually living up to the ideals. And part of the problem is you've bought into the same lies that we did, perhaps in a slightly different way, but you know, the same thing that came out of modernity, this materialism that considered that matter is all there is and that there is no soul and that there is no spiritual depth to be considered. He said, you're in the same position that we are. And this was true in the 70s. I think it's even more true today when not only are we much richer than we were in the 70s and thus more tempted to sort of latch onto our possessions, but also I think that the temptation towards these forms of socialism are even greater. And they're all predicated, you know, Solzhenitsyn would say, on our materialism, on our not seeing the human being as anything more than, you know, what the new atheists call moist robots who just need some, you know, need some oil and fixing. But we're actually spiritual creatures.
Seems to me that, you know, materialism today, maybe there's a tension. In one sense, it's waning as people are seeking for spirituality. You know, I've written about this, that I think in late secularism, the desire for spirituality often becomes irrational and kind of mythological. But it also seems that there's still this really strong current, and even in some ways stronger current of materialism that's seeped in just to, it's not just a couple people thinking it, this idea of kind of neurobiological determinism. Like you talked about the new atheists. And these are very popular thinkers that are basically arguing for materialism. And Solzhenitsyn is pretty clear that the fundamental error, and correct me if I'm wrong, of Marxism and of communism is precisely philosophical materialism, right? And the what he says, we've forgotten God.
No, that's exactly right. I mean, that, and that's why he said, you're not so different. You're not so different here in the West from what we were in the East. We've all bought the lie at different levels. And I think you're right that what happens to materialism is eventually people grow tired of it and they do seek out spiritual realities in much, much more dangerous ways. And I think that he would acknowledge that. I mean, that's part of the thing is that you have to, at a certain point, you have to be spiritual creatures. At one point in the Gulag Archipelago, you know, he comments that this is one of the things is that human beings have to provide these sort of reasons for things. And of course, ultimately, the reasons we provide are not going to be purely materialistic. They're going to be based in some sort of metaphysical claim about truth. And that's why you have to tell the big lie is to justify to yourself. So I think you're right that although materialism is in some sense waning, it still has a hold on us. And the reason why it has a hold on us is that we're kind of telling lies about spiritual reality.
Why don't you develop that? So maybe two things. Why don't you first just briefly give a quick summary of what you and what Solzhenitsyn means by materialism. So, because you actually used it in two ways, right? So one, there's a materialist ethos of acquisition. So pursuit of happiness gets reduced to acquisition of goods and pleasures and experiences, right? And then second, like the philosophical outlook. And on this podcast, you know, I've talked to Gary Saul Morrison, who's actually has an essay in your collection.
Yes.
Dan Mahoney on Solzhenitsyn and Carlo Lancelotti, who wrote on Augusto del Noce, who very much makes a similar case. He was writing in Italy during the 20th century and making very much a similar case to Solzhenitsyn, saying that the West had adopted Marxist atheistic, and he's quite strong about this, like materialist visions. So the thing I think that was really striking that I talked about with Carlo Lancelotti about is Del Noce said that he noticed around the 50s that the United States stopped using this idea of we're going to defeat the Soviets on this kind of Christian ideas of the dignity of the person and flourishing and changed. We're going to defeat you on productivity, material prosperity, and liberation, especially sexual liberation. And Del Noce said, in that moment, or that was the beginning of the Marxification of the West because we adopted their values. But so comment on that if you want. And then also maybe just like, what is materialism and then how did that work for us?
Yeah, I mean, you've correctly noted that there are two senses of materialism. One, you know, the sort of Madonna material girl kind of sense of acquisition or what, you know, what we call today often consumerism or something like that. And it's not unconnected to the philosophical version of materialism, which basically says that we are nothing more than, you know, matter in motion. and thus that our needs are purely material and that they can be satisfied through experiences which sort of send our atoms in motion in a particular way, in that sort of sexual way, or through food or through other goods. And I think it's interesting that you can say that, you know, like most things, there's a sort of vicious circle. You can kind of enter into these at any level and you'll get to the other one. If you start thinking purely about material gain and acquisition, eventually you're going to think philosophically only about the world in those terms. But if you think in those terms, then you're sort of condemning yourself to get back into thinking, well, the only way that I can satisfy my needs is through some sort of material reality. And I think that notion of sort of we being Marxified, having Marxified capitalism, is exactly right. And that's one of the things that Solzhenitsyn was so critical of the United States for, is that he said, you know, you've abandoned this original notion that you're made, right, in the image of God and have liberty under God and freedom under God, and that you're supposed to reach out and do things because, you know, of spiritual growth. And instead, all you've done is focus on the money. And so he was very critical of American businessmen because he said, look, you've fulfilled the prophecy of Lenin, right, that the businessmen will sell the rope by which they are hanged. So, you know, he saw that as our great weakness. And he said, look, I have no problem saying that the productivity levels in the West really have, you know, have put everybody in the truly Marxian countries to shame. And yet you all still have that same hangdog look that says that you're not satisfied. And that's a real problem.
I want to go to your essay on life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But you said, let's pause for a second and actually talk about this. So
yeah,
it's interesting because Solzhenitsyn's a conservative. He's deeply religious man, and he's criticizing capitalism.
Yeah.
And a lot of people, and I mean, I support generally a free competitive market economy. I mean, that's very complex. I mean, I think one of the things I've been talking about lately is we sometimes just use shorthand, like free market. Well, what does that mean? I mean, a free market, you know, means that we're enabling people to engage in commutative justice of exchange according to the principle of subsidiarity, which means that those closest to the problems handle it. And in order for commutative justice to take place, you need legal justice. And I'm being pedantic kind of on purpose, right?
Right.
Because
right.
You need legal justice. And then legal justice, well, okay, so you have rule of law and private property and clear title to land. And then you need a host of other things that are going on. And then you need a currency, right? And so there's all this kind of governmental structures that are setting things up for it to go. And then you want to make sure that there's not asymmetries of information that are problematic. And you want to make sure that monopolies and other kind of corruption are taking place. Okay. And now we get to this free exchange. But we just say, oh, free market. Well, I mean, that's like a pretty rich concept that we've reduced to the shorthand. Now we need shorthand because can you imagine if I tried to say that and more every time right. I talked? I mean, I would have like, you know, no one would ever listen to anything I ever said. But in a sense, I think sometimes, and I've talked about this before, we make the shorthand the thing, and then we make an error. Like, no, there's all these layers under there.
Yeah.
So I think that's, I think, one area to go. And then I think we have to take really seriously some of the problems, which we'll talk about actually in a couple of essays. You're right, we'll talk about, I mean, some of the contributors about the problem in America today, where you have a lot of wealth, a lot of success, but a lot of that wealth, a lot of the gains have been privatized to small groups. Some of the losses have been socialized to large groups. I had Chris Arnotti on the podcast, and we talked about his book, Dignity, and it talks about front row America versus back row America, and back row America has been left behind. So there's all these kind of questions we have to deal with. But in the same time, I think both you and I, we support free competitive market economies under the rule of law and with all the caveats. But it's very interesting because in the United States, you have some traditionalist critiques of capitalism from kind of conservatives, but a lot of the critiques of capitalism come from the left. And what's very interesting is that the left, and I say this broadly speaking, also hold some of those kind of materialist positions that Solzhenitsyn critiques. So I'm setting up maybe a problem that is not that clear yet, but I'd like to hear what you think about it. Is that in one sense, if you want really good cultural critiques of capitalism, and I do work on this, it comes from the left. They're the best on this, right? I think there's a growing critique among conservatives, which is some of which is good. Some of I think is maybe confused, but you know, these are complex issues. But what's interesting is that a lot of the critiques of capitalism come from kind of left people who maybe are advocating for socialism. But Solzhenitsyn would say, wait, no, it's the wrong critique of capitalism. But can you explain maybe, sorry, it took me a long time to get there, but can you explain Solzhenitsyn's position? Because he's not a critic of capitalism that argues for a large state because he just escaped that.
Right.
What's he arguing for?
Let's maybe start with the fact that when he talks about capitalism and socialism as systems, he kind of sees an asymmetry when you're just simply talking about them as kind of economic systems in that sort of shorthand. And he'll say that the problems of capitalism are those of the problems of every human being, whereas the problems of socialism are precisely because they get the human being wrong. But when he gets to the actual critique, he basically says that the problem is that in the sort of the capitalist countries, what you have is this notion of materialism, which considers only basically productivity and output and no sense of rights or duties or anything like that. And he says the problem is that then when people critique that capitalist system, right, they critique it from the left and they say, oh, well, the problem is, you know, we could make everybody equal and we could make everything work out and everybody could be wealthy and, you know, then we will have this sort of future state. And he says the problem is, when you do that, you're not actually getting out of the problem, which is considering only productivity and gains and, you know, gross domestic product and all of these sorts of categories. And he thinks that the reality is that what human beings need is the capacity to engage in what you and I would call, in that shorthand, free markets, but also to live in communities that have people who are convinced that we need to do something more than simply that which is legal, that which is, you know, which gets us the best, you know, bang for the buck, if you will. The best pleasure. So sometimes he will sound like a, you know, a kind of leftist when he'll say things like, you know, the idea of unlimited growth is abhorrent or something like that. But I don't think we need to think of him as in that sort of category. He's not one of these sort of return to the land and we should all be sort of 18th century Russian peasants or something like that. He believes that the gains that have been made money-wise are wonderful. And he thinks that it allows people to be able to actually act in a much better way. The problem is if they don't do that and if they don't consider themselves as part of a community and they don't seek spiritual growth, then they're simply going to go into the sort of the dog-eat-dog, war of all against all model. And that's going to lead down the path that's going to go not simply to a sort of, you know, benign form of Scandinavian social democracy, but it's going to go all the way to a kind of communism. So he thought that these sort of moderate versions of socialist critique really always got pushed out and people would either go, you know, go all the way to a communist totalitarianism or they would have to rethink it entirely and think about themselves as creatures under God.
Right. So it's like in a sense that a lot of the critiques, but right and left, for Solzhenitsyn are missing the point that it's not so much on the distributive model of the market that we're critiquing. It's the fundamental philosophical, cultural assumptions that underlie that. And is it based on human flourishing or is it based on something more kind of materialist? I mean, so like maybe let me put it this way. So Chris Harnadi in his book Dignity, we talked about this on the podcast that he uses this term called there's more to life than credentials, right?
Yeah.
So there's like there's non-credentialed layers of meaning that have been rejected, which I think overlaps in again with kind of C.S. Lewis, Joseph Ratzinger, this critique of the West that we've reduced everything to empiricism and anything outside of the empirical has no value. It's just kind of ephemeral. But that, as that shapes us, we begin to kind of identify, as you said, productivity, growth, acquisition, pleasure, experiences. Those become everything, but we lose family and home and other things. And the second thing that made me think of, and again, feel free to critique this, I'm not an expert in Nietzsche, but Nietzsche has this kind of concept, this idea of like this limited horizons, right? That it's the kind of the problem with humanitarianism. Dan Mahoney writes about this and others, that humanitarianism is this limited horizon, that what matters is physical comfort. And ultimately, that's not enough. It doesn't give the human person enough. And so even if we make comfort, which is not bad, and material growth, which is not bad, if we make that the end, actually we become dissatisfied.
Right.
Right. And then that leads to that starts to open up a lot of like a can of problems.
Well, and we kill the golden goose too, you know? I mean, this is other writers have pointed this out. The same thing that Solzhenitsyn did, which is too much comfort actually leads to a kind of death of the creature and a death of the community. And it's very similar to what, you know, many of those who are in that sort of free market tradition, you know, Wilhelm Röpke talks about this, about how, mm-hmm. you know, these entrepreneurial figures at first, you know, are going out and they're doing the thing because of it's exciting and you're meeting needs and you're doing all this stuff. And then once they become successful, then all of a sudden they kind of pull back and don't want to take any risks and they don't want to risk what they have. And pretty soon they're starting to involve themselves in the same sorts of, you know, corporatist activities, rent-seeking behaviors that, you know, they may have critiqued at the beginning. It's one of the big questions is why exactly does comfort, you know, basically kill our capacity to actually get the things that got us the comfort in the first place?
Right. Well, and also, I mean, and we'll get, this goes to kind of to your essay, but I think it's somebody, Dostoevsky or somebody says, like, you know, if everybody was perfectly comfortable, like man will just mess it up just to create problems. I mean, there's something there. And I think this goes right to your essay on looking at life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness from a Solzhenitsyn context. And you say that pursuit of happiness is, this is what you say in your essay, it's not that the pursuit of happiness is the problem. It's the pursuit of this worldly happiness, not primarily by clear consciousness leading to subjective well-being, but by a subjective well-being shorn of the notion of conscience at all. And so to keep the conscience quiet, you say, the pursuit of happiness has to fill his soul with lesser things. And this is what he does is in the Harvard address, where he says, quote, every citizen has been granted the desired freedom and material goods in such quantity and of such quality as to guarantee in theory the achievement of happiness. In the morally inferior sense of the word, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you write, but this theoretical achievement of material goods hits a snag because human beings were not satisfied by that, right?
No.
And then this goes to this point where we become unsatisfied, we're unhappy, there's depression, right? There's a loss of political will, the loss of courage and of taking risk, like you referred to Röpke. But also it then connects to the liberty element, where now, and feel free to add on this or correct it, but if I understood your essay, that so you have this mistaken notion of happiness, and now you've got liberty. So you have life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. You get the pursuit of happiness wrong. It also leads to liberty wrong, because now liberty becomes this kind of raw exercise of the will. You go beyond the norms and can to what Solzhenitsyn calls ignoble behavior, right? So you're almost moving in to an animalistic, just, I'm going to exercise my will to do whatever I want. And so you see this like fascination with death, with what Kirk and Babbitt call, and Eliot calls the diabolical imagination, right?
Yep.
It's almost like the desire for comfort creates a self-hatred. And Solzhenitsyn writes about this. There's a self-hatred. Could you develop that a little bit?
I mean, what's interesting about it is that, as you say, it brings us to think, well, you know, maybe then liberty is itself this raw exercise of the will. But the problem is that doesn't last either. That makes us unhappy. And, you know, the irony is then we're willing to chuck our liberty itself, because then we kind of blame it. And we think what we need is something stable. And I think that's what many people today want is, you know, they have that deep-seated desire for stability and they don't even want liberty anymore, because out of that false notion of happiness, they then acted on a false notion of liberty. And pretty soon, they start to hate all of that stuff and think, well, if only somebody could, you know, tell me what to do and make it all right again. And I think I quote in my essay, and maybe someone else does as well, you know, Solzhenitsyn gave an interview with Bernard Levin in the London Times in the 80s. And Levin said, you know, you seem to be saying that there are many people that were in the Soviet Union who were kind of willing to get rid of their own freedom. And he said, yes. And he said, do you think there are these people in the West? And Solzhenitsyn said, yes, I'm meeting them all right now. And so it's an irony, right, that, you know, instead of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, you know, my chapter argues that, you know, one way of thinking about Solzhenitsyn is that we've kind of taken it backwards, that we want happiness and liberty, both misconceived. And the irony is that they kill all of this misconceived idea kills any possibility of achieving true happiness or true liberty. And true happiness is ultimately for Solzhenitsyn spiritual growth, which can't be gotten out of material acquisition or out of just, you know, today we talk about experiences. And he says, mm-hmm. you know, that doesn't do it either. And true liberty can't be had out of simply acting out of whatever you feel like at the moment. Instead, true liberty has to be acted out of a concept of what liberty is for. And ultimately, he says that, you know, that's to act in a heroic way and to actually take risks for others. But that's the deep and dark secret that we have. I think that's why people, you know, as we were talking about before, I think that's why people are seeking out these sort of exotic spiritualities and these exotic political philosophies, because it's better to have, you know, a sort of a crazy idea that you can actually put yourself into that has a broader meaning than to be trapped in what you've already tried, which is, you know, money for nothing and the chicks for free.
I'm from the 80s, so I totally got that reference. Yeah. Don't they have another song called Everybody's Living for the Weekend or something?
Yeah,
like that?
I think so. Yeah.
So I wasn't.
Right.
A big
I mean,
fan,
and that says it perfectly, right? I mean,
what's the name of that band?
What is the name of that band?
Mark Knopfler.
Yeah.
Anyway,
yeah.
Matt Leonard would know. He knows everything about the 80s.
Right.
He would know all the lyrics. So anyways, okay, yeah. So now I'm distracted trying to figure out the name of that band, but I'm not going to. So I think what's an interesting point, and this comes through some of the other essays, and this is a bit of a vague question, but I think it relates to this, is one is I think it's interesting that, you know, this desire for experiences, the desire to like this kind of acquisition. And it's also what Arnotti would call this front row stuff. Like, you know,
yeah,
we're going to go and have this exotic experience in the jungle and do all this kind of stuff. I mean, and I travel a place. I like to do different things. So, I mean, I understand it. And I mean, sometimes, and I know in myself, part of it is a false desire for experiences. I mean, I know this, so I'm not throwing stones at anyone else except myself at this. But the other thing I think is it really makes us ideological. And this is right and left. And I think you can see it in the political climate of today in the United States and other places. It makes us more ideological because that, in a sense, gives us something to live for, right, outside of ourselves, which I think is another problem.
And yeah,
you can critique that. So first, why don't you do that? And then I have a second question. Do you think that's true, that maybe that's like I see in America on the right and the left, okay, this like hardcore, increasingly like angry ideology, the rejection of any other position, a taste for conspiracy theories, for demonizing others. I mean, do you think that this is just part of also like human being, when we're a little bit bored by our prosperity or by false notions of and not everybody's has prosperous. I mean, there are poor people in the United States, right?
Right.
I don't want to overstate this, but there's this kind of attachment to ideology.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, one way of thinking about it may be that, you know, when we do focus everything upon our sort of material acquisition, signs that we are in kind of the elite class, our experiences, you know, have you been to Cabo? Well, I have been. You know, when we do that sort of thing, you know, if we just say it out loud, it sounds like, well, I'm just a sort of a snob who is bragging about the things and the experiences that I'm able to purchase. And that doesn't sound very moral. But if you cast those signs, those credentialing, you know, signs, to talk about Arnotti, right, as sort of a sign that you are in the proper group and you ally them with a kind of ideological spin, then it sounds much better. And you don't have to think about the fact that, you know, you're out there, you know, marching for freedom and for justice and against inequity. But really what you're trying to do is keep yourself on top.
Right.
So I think, you know, I think there's a kind of people are searching for meaning and they have to find it. They can't do it in religion because that's not cool. So then they do these sort of ideological positions, which are often simply a fig leaf for their own desire to stay on the top of the, you know, at the head of the rat race and the top of the pillar.
Right. Yeah, because all of us, it's very easy to self-justify and find moral reasons for all of my great things that I do. I mean,
yeah,
it's just the nature. I mean, that's just every single one of us. So there's two questions I want to ask from that. One is, which I was going to say before, is it seems like this, and this comes through in some of the writers, like Solzhenitsyn, of course, writes about this, Dostoevsky. Human beings want suffering.
Yeah.
Like in one sense, we hate it. You know, like Lewis talks about, like, he just dreads the idea of suffering. I do too. I'm afraid of suffering. And yet in another sense, if we don't have suffering, then we feel like we're not alive. And so I think what you see is, one, Of course, this is traditional Orthodox practice, right? Whether it's Russian or Orthodoxy, you know, Roman Catholicism, Judaism, there's fasting that takes place. You have to deny yourself, right? You see the Stoics too. And I think it's interesting because you're seeing with a lot of materialists and hedonists, for example, like Tim Ferriss, for example, is very popular. You know, he's kind of a utilitarian hedonist, but really like Seneca. All, you know, all these like big followers, like let's deny ourselves, you know, by doing physically hard things. And that's good. You know, I mean, I think I ultimately think it falls exactly into Solzhenitsyn's critique because of materialism, because it's like an experience of suffering, which is different from, say, a fast in a traditional, say, Russian Orthodox, Catholic, Jewish way, because it's still self-centered and self-directed as opposed to other directed. And I think it's even a danger. By the way, it's a danger for, I mean, both of us are Catholic. It's a danger. You know, you fast. I mean, I like to fast so I can lose weight and look better.
Right.
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 But I think like the desire for meditation, a lot of it's kind of pseudo-biblical, pseudo-Jewish, pseudo-Catholic.
Well,
stuff.
I think you've pointed out, I mean, it's ultimately sort of
simulacrums. Well,
it's, yeah, it's a simulacra, but it's because it's self-directed. And second of all, it's done in a kind of technocratic way. Like, well, I have the,
very, you know, much so
thin thighs in 30 days and the five steps to blah, blah, you know, and it's as if we can change ourselves simply by changing, you know, patterns or getting the right stuff or doing the right things in the right order. And the reality is that anybody who's ever grown in any way knows that it's a very, very rocky and up and down journey. And it's often a case in which, yeah, you do have to put forth effort, but ultimately there's a kind of grace involved in being able to see yourself and being able to see what you need to do. And so it's both selfish and a little too mechanical.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, this is, so I'm still working on how to articulate this, but there's something, so like I'll, you know, read some of these guys who are into like the meditation, the Stoics and the suffering. I mean, there's some things I learned from them, you know,
yeah.
But generally I find it like not satisfactory. And partially because I think of the two things you said, it's self-centered, self-directed. And so it ultimately, it's the same critique that Solzhenitsyn and Del Noce are making of the West. It's a hollowed out man. It's like Nietzsche's last man. Okay. But I know I'm the last man, but I'm going to at least go into like a really hot sauna and then a cold bath. And then I'm going to run and do an ultra marathon and meditate. Okay. But for what? For who?
Yeah.
Right. What's the purpose of it? And so I think there's something self-centered to it, but I also think just very utilitarian, technocratic. And so while I like the Stoics, and I think there's some interesting people doing some interesting work on the modern Stoics, a lot of it's just not satisfactory. It's like it's missing the point and the technocratic element to it. It's still, it kind of, I always mention this is like Yuval Harari, for example, he just thinks death is a technical problem,
right?
So death, sex, happiness, it's just a technical problem. We just have to solve it. You know, what's the life hack for this? And again, I don't want to be like overly curmudgeonly. I sometimes will get benefits. So that's a good idea.
Right.
That's a, you know, but spiritually, it doesn't solve the problem that Solzhenitsyn is getting to, that we actually want real suffering. And so, you know, for example, and this is, I have confirmation bias, the both of us have confirmation bias on this, what I'm about to say. And that is, I mean, what creates a lot more spiritual growth for me is that I have seven children.
Yeah.
And that my wife says, you know, don't be selfish. And
I think you meant suffering first, right?
Yeah. So, and great joy. But no, but I mean, like, you know, I'm challenged by my wife and the children. Like, the facts are, I'm selfish.
Yeah.
There's just no way around it. And when you have all these people in your house that you have to pay attention to, and you have eight?
Seven.
Okay. So, you know, so there's confirmation bias there, right?
Yeah.
But the facts are, like, that basic kind of element of life, right? It's not a technocratic hack to my selfishness. It's just I have children and a wife who require me to not be the selfish jerk that I want to be constantly. And that pushes me out of myself. And it's sense like that it goes to the point, if we don't have things that are pushing us towards suffering, towards self-giving. I mean, my life's easy too, but then we try to find it in these extremes. And this is something that kind of, it almost comes to the point, if we don't get it in the right way, we can become self-destructive to create suffering for ourselves. And we see that a lot in the West. How do you react to that?
Oh, I think that's exactly right, that people are, Well, I mean, you know, I think you've done a bit of work with, you know, Robert Nisbet, who, you know, often attributes almost all of our problems to, you know, to boredom in a certain sense, that we get bored with a life of easy comfort. And so then we, out of boredom, we would rather be unhappy and suffer, you know, from some crazy thing than simply to have things go on as they are. I mean, one of the themes of Solzhenitsyn's writings, and I would say that there are two themes that I see in his writings that maybe, you know, out of confirmation bias as a Catholic who studied theology, is one is his sort of notion of conscience that we've talked about before, which is, you know, not simply a sort of a sense of right and wrong, but a sense that there is a moral voice speaking from God telling us that there is a right and a wrong and that this life means more than anything. But the other part is a kind of a doctrine of providence. And you see this very strongly in the Gulag Archipelago, which, as Gary Saul Morrison says in his essay in our book, is a kind of Bildungsroman, basically a story about a coming of age. And it's a very particular story of coming of age of a man who believed in all the technocratic solutions of Marxist-Leninism, who came to believe that, you know, they were the wrong thing. And he eventually understood his own time, even in the Soviet prison camps, in the Gulag, as a kind of providential blessing that allowed him to escape from a false notion of himself, of man, of the world. And that suffering was something that he, you know, he blessed God for.
No, it's tough. I mean, I just want to say, like, it's easy for us to talk about this. I don't want to bless God for suffering. But I think that this is partially why the Gulag Archipelago, by Solzhenitsyn's writings and the other Russian writers that are discussed in the book, I think are both like very disturbing and compelling.
Yeah,
because they point to this, our human nature wants more from life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness than the kind of contemporary idea, which is acquisition, comfort, entertainment.
And credential, too. I mean, I think that really is. I mean, it's interesting, as you were talking about Stoicism, I was thinking about, you know, another sort of modern writer who saw the futility of our ways, but couldn't quite go the whole, you know, the whole direction to religion per se. And that was Tom Wolfe. Mm-hmm. You know, in his novels, he always ends up pointing these characters to, you know, to Seneca or to the Stoic tradition as a whole. And he was keenly aware that human beings needed status. But the problem is, I think Stoicism doesn't really answer that exactly either. Only a kind of religious vision in which we're made in the image of God and have a destiny for something like glory, right? That we do have credential, we have status, but it's a different kind of status because it's a status in the eyes of God and of the angels and of really, really good people, the saints who are focused on that.
So let me push you on that just for a second. So, you know, again, both of us are Catholics, so we could have, you know, a discussion where we say, you know, Stoicism, not enough, Catholicism, the best.
Yeah.
I mean, but I think, you know, there are a lot of people who are into Stoicism. They find it useful. I mean, I like Stoics.
And yeah, absolutely.
An influence. And you're a philosopher and a theologian. You know that there's a Stoic influence. But I'd like you to do something for me. I did this a little bit off of Solzhenitsyn, but I think related. So a lot of people would say, oh, come on, you just want to give us a religious answer. And so I'll make it a dual critique of your, I'd like you to respond to the critique. Say, I could let you get away easily with just saying, yeah, Stoicism is not enough. But I want you to tell me why you think Stoicism is not enough. And related to that is this critique of Solzhenitsyn. I mean, isn't Solzhenitsyn just kind of a curmudgeon who's saying, you know, like men have forgotten God? Like, okay, you know, that's the same old Christian, you know, apologetic that we hear all the time. But in Christian societies, there's a lot of evil and unhappiness too. You know, so that's a two-part question. One is, I want to push you on Stoicism. And then two, I want to say, like, aren't you and Solzhenitsyn just kind of advocating for you for Catholicism and he for orthodoxy as the solution to our problems? I mean, it seems kind of insufficient.
Well, okay, let's take them in order then. I mean, Stoicism, when I say that it's insufficient, I mean that in the sense that it can't provide the ultimate answers, but it ultimately is a kind of human wisdom, and all human wisdom is from God, but it's a kind of wisdom that doesn't crack the nut of the entire human person. You know, and I'd say the same thing about Zen or the Confucian tradition. All of these things have important elements, but because they don't set out what I say, the origin of the human being as being made in the image of this God. And I can't help but be a kind of partisan of the Jewish and Christian view of this. And they don't have a particular view of our destiny either, which is to dwell with God forever. And I think it's, you know, the Christian vision there is based in the Jewish tradition and maybe, you know, goes a little farther than that, but it has the same notion that we're made in the image of God, meant to be in his likeness and to have that likeness fulfilled and to go on. I think because you don't have the beginning and the ending right in something like Stoicism, I think ultimately it's unsatisfying because we want to have those sorts of ultimate answers. With regard to Solzhenitsyn.
So may I just jump in for a second? So I think it's interesting. I think there's something else too that I would add is that there's something very profound about the deep affirmation of being that takes place with what you're saying.
Yeah.
So in a sense, and that's also where there's a division. So is being good, right? And so like one of the key ideas that I think, what are ideas that shape me? One of them is all things are good insofar as they exist. And like Ratzinger has these homilies on Genesis from like the 80s, where I think I've mentioned this before, maybe on this podcast, but where he talks about what happens is that in the Hebrew Bible, in Genesis, it's a de-divinization of the world.
Yeah.
And so that's it's created by God, but it's also created by God good. So we're not the dragon's flesh, you know, the world is not the product of a demiurge or the dragon's flesh. It's like that suffering has this meaning and potential redemptive character to it, which I think is also essential to the Solzhenitsyn point. So that the Stoic accepts life as it is, which you see in like, say, the Carmelite tradition, John of the Cross, or Teresa, or the church fathers say, okay, you have to accept the way it is, you have to accept suffering. But that what we'll call the Jewish and Catholic Orthodox tradition is it's this affirmation of the goodness of being. Mm-hmm. And with that, the affirmation of each individual person who has, as you say, a destiny, which really is, in a sense, sets the mystery of the human person whose suffering has meaning. And this, I think, is what, as you said earlier, this is why Solzhenitsyn recognizing the gulag, suffering actually can have meaning and redemptive value. It's not simply just the pain of living.
Well, and it allows Solzhenitsyn a kind of charity and compassion that I think is not necessarily available in some of these philosophical traditions. Like if you're a bad Stoic, you just stink, you know, and Solzhenitsyn doesn't have that. I mean, he has a great sympathy in all of his writings for people who've gone off the deep end, when he considers, mm-hmm. you know, the blue caps, the investigators and the guards and all the people, you know, he doesn't think to himself, you know, thank God I've gotten beyond those little schmucks. What he thinks is, you know, I was an army officer who had the same sort of view that I was on the top and it didn't matter what happened to people on the bottom. And, you know, it's a there but for the grace of God go I sense, because he understands that the deepest problems are in the human heart. But that in that human heart, which is divided, is the possibility of both good because we are made in the image of God and have this potential, but also great evil as well. So he feels free to thunder against evil, but it's never from the standpoint of, well, I've got it down.
Mm-hmm. Now that's, I think that's important. I mean, I think that's in fact the challenge of each of us to recognize that but for the grace of God go I. That you know, what's the book, Ordinary Men, right? You too could become a Nazi, you know? And I talk actually about this, I think, on the podcast on Rene Girard, where he just makes this point, like that if you scapegoat the other, it's proof that you're going to fall this way. Whereas if you're recognizing, well, no, that could be me very much. And so, and I'm just right on that edge of doing that, I think is actually a very, that's something also that's drawing to Solzhenitsyn, because you read Solzhenitsyn and you are critiqued. I mean, like you don't finish reading Solzhenitsyn and think, oh, I feel great. You really realize, oh my goodness. But you also sense this charity that he himself had failed. He knows he could fail again. I think that's right. So that kind of leads us then to that second question of, you know, what do you say to the person who says, come on, Solzhenitsyn, you're just a curmudgeon, you know, and you write, some of this comes up in some of the essays, like, okay, your time is over. I forget who said it. Like the Gulag Archipelago is great, but now we're done with you.
Yeah.
You're just this curmudgeon who's off in the West and you're just trying to foist your you know, religious views on us. Well, how do you respond to that?
Well, I think that's connected to what we were just talking about, because Solzhenitsyn, and, you know, and I think this is deeply involved in that understanding of his of conscience, is that Solzhenitsyn is not just saying, well, you know, only holy Orthodox will, you know, or something like that. You know, his depictions of all these people in the Gulag and in the system as a whole are not ones in which you identify the good people and the bad people, and the good people are always with the religious hats. Mm-hmm. He identifies these good people who are like himself or like Ivan Denisovich in One Day in the Life, right? Who are kind of in the middle. Mm-hmm. They're not really sure about things. They're trying to act out of what they know best. But at the same time, you get the sense that the reality is ultimately those who are capable of acting out of conscience and not just sort of, you know, listening to it, are those who actually acknowledge God. Certainly, he acknowledges the people who are sort of good atheists in a way, but the vast majority of the people who make decisions to act in the Gulag are those who come out of a tradition in which they understand God. This is not to say that everybody who claims to be a Christian or a good Jew is going to do that. And he identifies many, many unholy, quote unquote, holy people. Right. But it is to say that it is a kind of, it's necessary, but it's not sufficient in a way to act out of conscience. And he's willing to give the good lines to whoever has them. Mm-hmm. But generally speaking, he sees that those who have a deep and abiding faith that is practiced are the ones who are going to actually be the ones who say things. When he talks about people, you know, being tortured, he has a wonderful story about this woman who supposed, this old woman in her 80s, you know, old peasant woman who had supposedly hosted, you know, some bishop, the Metropolitan of Moscow or somebody when he had come through, and they're interrogating her and they say, you know, you must tell us, you know, pounding on the table, you must tell us where he is now. And of course she says, you know, I am ready to face God right now. And so go ahead, you can cut me into little pieces, but you will never find out what, you know, what I have to know. And, right. And it's quite remarkable because that's, you know, in contrast to even his own depiction of his own interrogation, in which he kind of gives in and signs these documents that, you know, that attest to his political crimes and many other, you know, young, strong figures. But it's really, you know, this old woman who's capable of basically saying, no, not on your life. I know what's going to happen to me when I die. I will face God. So I think that's just the reality, is that having a religious conviction that the voice of conscience isn't just a kind of taboo, but is instead a voice of God ultimately, is a sine qua non for really acting on it. Now, are there exceptions? Sure. But in general, the rule holds. And I don't think that's any less true today than it was in his time, or any less true in any other time.
Now, I think this is some part of the takeaway is that if, and this goes to kind of the point of his critique of materialism and what you said earlier about this, and I talked about the affirmation of being.
Yeah.
That if matter is all there is, then it doesn't matter what you do. But if the human being is more than simply just the product of, you know, biological, neurobiological, chemical forces, and matter is good and being is good, and human beings do have dignity and value beyond their utility, then we need this deep conscience and affirmation of the goodness of being, and ultimately we need this spiritual religious outlook or foundation for that to ever work, because otherwise it gets compromised. You know, you mentioned about good atheists, and I was in a conversation with a friend about this question because I was reading a book. It's making an argument against kind of the new atheists and everything. But at one point, the writer, and it's an interesting book, he says something to the effect, you know, like, you know, I think atheists can be good. And we always say that, oh yeah, you know, as we're religious, atheists can be good. And of course, the answer to that, of course, atheists can be good. Like we know, both you and I know people who don't believe in God,
yeah,
who are morally sound, good people. But I was thinking about this a bit and I thought, you know, do I believe that anymore on any meaningful level? Meaning, can individual atheists be good? Of course they can.
Yeah.
Right. But can a fully atheistic materialist society be good? And it seems like atheism is this luxury when there's religious cultural capital, right?
That's right.
So what I talk about sometimes is the power of the invisible. I talk about this a lot, that there's all these layers of things. It relates to that even discussion we had earlier about the market, right? So when you live in a culture that affirms the goodness of the person, the goodness of being, the goodness of family, can you be, of course, you can be an atheist. But if your entire civilization goes that direction, we get the gulags.
Yeah.
And I think this is where once that cultural set, and this is, tell me if you think this is Solzhenitsyn, but once that cultural capital is gone and rejected and replaced by full materialism, that's when Dostoevsky's famous line kicks in about, without God, everything is permissible.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I mean, and Solzhenitsyn goes that direction in his 1983 Templeton lecture. Basically says this is the problem, is that in the West, you've spent most of your spiritual capital and you only have a dwindling supply of it. And so there's, you know, he says there's no way out but up. You cannot solve these problems with technical solutions. You really have to seek God. You know, a wonderful article, wonderful in the sense that it explains this very well, not wonderful in its reality, is Gary Saul Morrison had a piece in, I think, 2018 in Commentary called Among the Unbelievers, in which he was actually laying this out using Solzhenitsyn as well as some of these other writers to show that the Soviet project, the Marxist-Leninist project, was in its heart atheist. And by that, he was trying to show that it's not just that we didn't believe in God, but that it really was a situation in which, well, everything was permitted in one sense, but everything was permitted to those who were in power. And so he quotes Lenin, you know, talking about the fact that, you know, we are not going to permit, not only we're not going to permit any religion, but we're not going to permit any religious substitutes like atheist versions of natural law. We're not, you know, even Kant's categorical imperative is sort of, you know, off the table, because it sounds like there's something outside of the human person which sets limits on the state. And so, you know, Gary Morrison's piece is, you know, I talked to him one time and he said, yeah, you know, I've written it for, you know, friends and colleagues that I think, you know, could go farther. And as you say, we can sort of say, well, you know, everybody can be good. But the reality is, in the end run, you cannot have an entire society that's run on this. You need to have a good number of people who actually believe that there's something that's outside of themselves that judges them and also provides for them an end or a goal for their existence.
Right. Well, I think just one, it's very interesting because it's very realistic. Because we live in a culture where technical solutions are primary, I call this like the primary of the technical, we think, oh, come on, give me a practical, pragmatic solution. But what's very interesting is that's exactly the most kind of concrete, realist thing.
Yeah.
What you just said is if you have lived in a whole culture that doesn't have it, if there's nothing outside you that's judging you, you can justify all sorts of wicked behavior. And so I'll put a link to that Gary Saul Morrison piece in Commentary. And then I don't think you've heard it, Dave, but I interviewed him for this podcast on
an essay. No, I did not hear that episode. No.
Okay, well, that's shameful.
I know. He's wonderful.
He's great. It's on Lenin Think. It's like, yeah. So listeners, if you haven't heard this lecture, I mean, discussion with Gary Saul Morrison on Lenin, I recommend it. And that's good because you'll be listening to the Moral Imagination podcast. So let's switch gears here before we end. So your book has a lot of different essays in it. And so I recommend listeners to go get the book. It is a little bit expensive, but it's definitely worth reading. And so one of the title, you talk about the Russian soul and the West. And so there's two essays towards the end of the book on what Russia has to say to America today. So I want to talk about those two essays, but let me start actually with the first one and a little bit of a kind of question, critique, worry that I have. So the first essay is really kind of a summary of a lot of Russian thinkers and Russian writers and the idea of the Russian soul. And again, correct me if I've misrepresented any of this, of course, where there's this tension between, like, so Russia makes Americans nervous, first of all, right? Why? Be like, for those, you and I, we grew up during the Cold War. I mean, a Russian means a communist, you know?
Right.
And so we just watched the other day with my family, the hockey movie called Miracle, right? It's just a great, great film. And it's interesting to just see the kind of like the sense of the tension between the United States and the Soviets. So you have this kind of tension there. And then of course, now right? In the last several years, you have all these debates like, is Russia influencing our elections? And so, and then people worried about kind of Putin going back to Russia. And then the sense that Russia is a worry. And so the author, what's the name of the first piece?
Nathan Nielsen.
Nathan Nielsen, yeah. So he kind of addresses this. I mean, it's very interesting. And he brings this out and he says, there's this tension between kind of a Russian nationalism that makes people nervous and then a Russian universalism, and that the Russian soul has something to say to all of the world, and that he goes between these writers. So I want you to talk about that. But I also want to say one of the things that kind of made me a bit worried was, at least the way that it's presented, is this idea that, you know, in the Russian soul, there's this love of humanity, right? This universal values, right? Or there's this kind of Russian nationalism element, but also you've got this technocratic of the Soviet system that just crushed people and killed, you know, tens of millions of people through the totalitarian systems. And Dave, for me, when I read it about the universalist kind of values of love of humanity, it sometimes feels to me that's two sides of the same coin. Like, one is this sentimental humanitarian love of all of humanity and bring the world together. Well, that doesn't really work. What really works is individual love of human beings right in front of you in a concrete way. And that when that fails, and I will call that, I'm going to put this in the language of the idyllic imagination, right? We get the diabolical imagination of the concentration camps and the gulags. And so, you know, anyway, first comment on that. Tell me if I've missed something. But then I'd like to then move into these two essays on, you know, Russia, like, has something to say to the United States is a little bit, I don't know, it makes people think, wait, what are you talking about? What does Russia have to teach us? But part of this book is that not just Solzhenitsyn, but in a sense, the Russian experience through suffering, and but also the Russian writers have actually something to say to modern Westerners in general, Europeans, but specifically to modern Americans.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that you're right that, you know, any form of universalism is going to have a danger. But I think, you know, there has to be a kind of universalism about our ideas, because people are always going to want to be talking about truth with a capital T. And I think, you know, Nielsen's essay is, I think, not so much arguing for a sort of a generic universal. He says at one point that, you know, there's no such thing as a kind of pure ethereal universalism.
Right.
But he says that, you know, versions of universalism that are true and have something to offer to us all are going to be ones that actually come out of real communities. You know, he says something like, no universalism can be so pure as to ignore the tangible local realities of communities, lands, and peoples. And thus, you know, Russian universalism springs from sort of Russian identity itself. And there is something to learn from that experience. We've talked about the sort of the negative lessons that if you go in this full materialist philosophical direction, where you can go, but there is something to learn from the Russian village and from the Russian experience as well, just as there is from everywhere else. One of the other essays in the book that I think, you know, treats this very well in a kind of more specific way is Lee Trepanier's essay on basically what Russia can teach, you know, American hillbillies. And he's pointing out the fact that in the 19th century in Russia, there were these two sort of tendencies that were trying to get people out of the village and out of this sort of parochial view. And one of them was a kind of, you know, liberal, classical liberal, if you will, westernizing tendency. And the other one was revolutionary. And, you know, both of these were saying, well, we want pure universalism in some sense that will overwhelm our own history. And both of those were wrong. But also wrong was, in many ways, the so-called Slavophiles, those who thought, well, we can just do everything as it has been done forever in Russia, you know, from the beginning. And I think, you know, what Lee's article does very well is to show that, you know, there are going to be truths that are present in almost all sides, but you have to actually keep the concrete and the real and the local and the person in there. Otherwise, any form of universalism is going to end up, you know, precisely as you said, is just the other side of the coin of, you know, totalitarianism. So I think there's a perfect balance that's to be made. And I think Solzhenitsyn's own thought bears that out, that he believed in democracy in a sense, but he also didn't think that the structures of democracy were a kind of savior or salvation. He thought that when Russia left behind its Soviet past, he said, you know, we couldn't have gone to democracy in a worse way in the 1990s. And he was often accused of being an anti-democrat, but he said, no, you just need the preconditions for a real and authentic democracy, and you can't just sort of create them with structures.
Yeah, so in that, that's the essay, I think, where he compares Dostoevsky and then, how do you say, Turgenev.
Turgenev, yes.
Turgenev.
Yeah,
Turgenev.
Fathers and sons.
He makes this point, pardon my bad pronunciation here, between what he called, as you said, the Slavophiles and the Westerns, and that And the fathers and son element, and that there's this is, I think, very interesting. He said that is a parallel to 2016, 2020 American elections, the way red state, blue state, how do we think about capitalism? How do we think about elites? How do we think about, I think there's overlap. We've talked about Chris Harnadi's book, Dignity. Yeah. And I think as I was reading that chapter, I was like, oh, this is like some of the very same themes Chris Harnadi talks about, as do others, like Orrin Cass, I think, talks about some of this, and like the now and future worker. So I thought that was it. Maybe, can you just develop a little bit of that? I think, and I think you're aware of some of these discussions and debates in America.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be hyper-political, but just, I thought it was really interesting that here he is, 19th century, two writers, and he applies it to contemporary America.
Yeah, I mean, Lee's essay is just excellent insofar as he looks at those different accounts, one from the Brothers Karamazov, Dostoevsky's great work, and looks at the sort of the dialogue between these various characters, some of whom, like Ivan, who is the atheist figure, are seeking the revolutionary path, and others, and then there are the kind of the traditional Slavophiles. But ultimately, it's the spiritual vision of somebody like Father Zosima that wins out. In the other book, in Turgenev's Fathers and Sons, again, it's not so clear a kind of a winner, if you will. But there is the realization at the end of the book that there has to be a kind of balance between all of these competing interests. And what Lee Trepanier does in the end of his essay is he says, yeah, we can apply this. We actually do need to take care of these local communities. We do need international trade, but we also need to care for these communities, and we need to allow people to experience being part of the market, what John Paul called the circle of exchange. And I haven't seen Kevin Williamson, when he reviewed J.D. Vance's Hillbilly Elegy, was kind of scoffing that it's basically these communities, it's all their fault, they're dysfunctional, why don't we just get rid of these communities? And he has a new book, I haven't read it yet, which is supposedly an answer. And I'm kind of curious if he's developed that sort of thought or nuanced it, because it seems to me that offering opportunity for people to get out of their village is one thing, but saying, well, that village doesn't matter is another, right? Because people actually care about where they came from, and they don't want their communities, even if they have dysfunction, to be destroyed. They want them to be flourishing, right, such that the people in them, not all of whom can leave, can actually live lives that are worthy and dignified, and reaching out towards something that's bigger and better than simply the self in either a dysfunctional or a kind of modern materialist functional sense.
Right. I mean, I think, I'm not trying to make this an advertisement for my podcast, but these are exactly the things that I talked to Chris Harnadi about. And I mean, he makes a couple of points related to that. Like, one is, he says, a lot of the fault, we kind of blame the poor people.
Yeah.
Right? And he actually has a really good essay called The Rotten Culture of the Rich. And I'll put links to that. They're on the Harnadi episode, but I'll put them in links to this episode as well at themoralimagination.com. But that in fact, a lot of the cultural problems are the rich. And you go to this point of like the self-serving culture, the kind of what people call the kleptocracy,
yeah,
right? Where the gains have been realized by a few people. I mean, this is something, so is a bit off the thing we're on now, but I think this is a problem actually that, say people who support free competitive economies like you and I do have. So we, in a sense, what we say is, okay, globalization and free trade benefits the aggregate. And yes, while there's some losers, it's better for people in the general, right?
Yeah.
And so we'll make the deal. We'll make that trade because it's better for everybody. And part of it, of course, there are people who take a hit for the team. Okay. So how do we deal with the people taking a hit for the team. Well, part of the kind of implicit deal is, though, because it's better in the aggregate, we're going to find interesting ways to redistribute. But then people who like free markets and conservatives are like, well, wait, we don't want redistribution. But that's kind of implicitly part of the deal. I mean, it doesn't necessarily mean it has to be done in a specific way through the welfare state or through a universal basic income. There are lots of interesting things, but I think there's almost like it's almost like we'll make this deal and we'll take an almost economic textbook view, like, well, you know, there's creative destruction, but in 6 months they'll find another job. And I think what J.D. Vance and Crisanotti and other people are showing is, well, no, of course, it's not 6 months. Sometimes it's two generations. Sometimes it really destroys a community. And we have to think about those communities because there are values beyond utility. There are values of the nation, values of communities, values of home. And not everybody wants to leave. This is another point Ardani makes. Not everybody wants to leave. People want to stay and they have families. They have to stay. You can't simply just create one standard of what he calls the front row. And I think in this case would be the fathers and sons, the Western standard,
right,
of kind of technocratic material acquisition and, you know, kind of a global view versus the sons, right, who are the kind of the Slavophile, which says, well, something here matters, the land matters. But then you don't want to take this, correct me if I'm getting if I'm misrepresenting the essay, but he's arguing you don't want to overly take the Slavophile position either, because then that becomes, it can often become kind of inward, it can become xenophobic and a host of other problems. Why don't you develop that out a little bit? I mean, yeah. Am I getting that right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, and that's one of the things that is important, especially, you know, in the essay about Dostoevsky, is that Dostoevsky clearly thinks that these sort of westernizers of various sorts and the revolutionaries are getting, you know, obviously the revolutionaries, but even the westerners are getting things wrong about this, that the, you know, the peasant class, the sort of lower classes has genuine virtues, but you cannot be sentimental about it. I think the problem is we sort of swing in the American context between a sort of sentimentality about poorer communities, whether they be black or white or what have you, and then a kind of judgment of them.
Like a disdain, sentimentality or disdain.
Yeah, kind of disdain that, well, it's all their own fault and, well, forget them anyway, or if they want to, we'll give them some money to get out of town. And of course, you know, as you say, a one-size-fits-all solution just isn't going to work because not everybody wants to leave their community. They, you know, many of them, they have their family there. I mean, that's one of the things that makes life often much more bearable is when you have those extended relations there who, you know, as they say about family, it's where if you come home, they have to take you in. And, you know,
not just bearable too. I mean, I know you mean this, but like that's the people make choices to sacrifice, say, credential, technical, or monetary material gains for things they value more deeply, like family.
Yeah.
Right. And I think so that's this tension. I think it also comes just down to also one of the themes of the whole podcast, but also of Solzhenitsyn, that we're dealing with human persons. We're not dealing with matter.
Right.
Or, you know, like material cogs in the social machine. We're dealing with human persons who are unique and unrepeatable. And again, this goes back to why that idea of conscience and the person and matter, yeah, the goodness of being, I should say, actually are important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, and that's why I like the essay is that it's trying to get at that directly and say, look, we have to look at these people as human beings, neither good, neither bad, you know, and not think of them as simply, well, what do we call labor? You know,
a factor of production.
A
human resource.
A human resource, right? I mean, they're not that. They are people, and they matter, and also their communities matter. And I think that's something that everybody's trying to get the right balance. As you say, the solution isn't necessarily, you know, one size fits all like UBI or some sort of another government program. We have enough of those. And you know, part of the difficulty with many of those government programs is that they end up simply being another way of distributing wealth, not actually to the people who need it, but to more people who are sort of in that middle and, you know, credentialed class instead of actually helping people where they are. So I mean, it's a challenge to think clearly about how we're going to do that and take as a first principle in any step that we take to help society to think about the reality of what these people are.
But I think, yeah, I think it goes to this two things. One is we have to put the person at the center and understand human beings, and we have to take family seriously. But also we have to, I think, be less ideological. These are complex problems, and we have to think about them. And I think, and part of it is if we're in a technocratic mindset, we don't have the tools to think about them.
Right.
And it's a challenge we have. So I've taken a lot of your time. I want to end by kind of switching to the other lecture on America. And hold on, because I've got it on the Kindle, it's always,
William Jason Wallace.
And what's the title
Rage
of that one?
Freedom.
Rage for Freedom, yeah. And I want to end with that. Again, feel free to talk about anything that he talks about there. But I think it actually goes to these kind of key takeaways of Solzhenitsyn and what Solzhenitsyn has to say for the West. Because this is about American culture, but it seems to me that Solzhenitsyn is not simply just talking about America or Russia. It's a critique of the Enlightenment.
Yeah.
And not like, you know, so Joseph Ratzinger, Benedict XVI, he has a moderated view of the Enlightenment. He thinks there's some serious problems, but he says it also comes out of a Christian culture. And some of it was a reaction against the failures of Christianity to live up to its principles, right? So, right. And there are, you know, many Enlightenments. My colleague at the Acton Institute, Sam Gregg, writes about, you know, the many types of the Enlightenments that are there. But it's a critique of this Enlightenment that actually is the same critique that Edmund Burke made in his book on the Reflections of Revolution in France, when he talks about the moral imagination, right? That we've got this limited reductionist view of rationality. It's the same critique that Ratzinger makes. And so he talks about, he says, although the West has not experienced the iron grip of communism, Solzhenitsyn argues the religious situation in the West is in many ways more precarious than in the East. Okay. Mm-hmm. Which is, I think, so probably, wait, what are you talking about? Right. So he says, Westerners, he writes, this is, what's his name? Jason Wallace. Jason Wallace. Yeah. Sorry. The PDF Kindle makes it hard for me to see that name.
Yeah.
Jason Wallace. He says, Westerners are experiencing their own version of a quote, drying up of religious consciousness. The strength of religious meaning for a life of moral responsibility is being sapped from Western countries. And he says it's more dangerous even than a violent assault from without, right? Because we're losing the meaning and purpose of moral life. And he says, so he goes on, traditional ideas of good and evil become subject to cynicism and ridicule. They lose their common sense meaning for individuals and individual decisions and instead are relegated to, quote, political class or consideration of short-lived value. So I think it's important. So I think this is why it's hard to read Solzhenitsyn. It's easier for us because both of us are Catholics, okay? But if you're a little not sure where you are and you're kind of wrestling with these questions, we live in a culture where, to quote Wallace, traditional ideas of good and evil are subject to cynicism. And so Solzhenitsyn writes, quote, a dire consequence of this shift, it has become embarrassing to appeal to eternal concepts, embarrassing to state that evil makes its home in the individual human heart before it enters a political system.
Yeah.
End quote. So I think, you know, John Paul's very clear that structures of sin exist, but they're always rooted in personal sin. And I think it's the reason it's uncomfortable. It's like, it's almost like we're on a side dialogue. Like the mainstream discussion and narrative, it's embarrassing to talk about eternal concepts or evil that makes its home in the human heart. And Solzhenitsyn is saying, I mean, like it's kind of sad because it's almost like it's the dominant narrative of the West is blocked off from hearing Solzhenitsyn. But that seems to be his, like one of the key takeaways, that you must wrestle with the fact that empiricist Enlightenment rationality is incoherent on its own terms, and it's insufficient to deal with the human heart or with evil or with political evil. And if you want to take political evil seriously, you must deal with the human heart.
That's right. You know, you said a couple of times that Solzhenitsyn's a conservative, but you could equally well say that he's a liberal too, but that liberal in the sense that he understands that, you know, liberal structures and liberal habits are only capable of being held on to and developed in this context of all of the stuff that's behind them. And that's why, again, I mean, I think many people do sort of write him off because he does actually appeal to something that's more than simply liberal precepts or more than, you know, more than legal structures or more than the free economy. He says, no, there's this vision that's behind that has to be that has to be grasped in order for you to actually be the right kind of liberal, for you to be the right kind of Democrat. And, you know, again, as you say, it's embarrassing for people. You know, that's how Wallace puts it. It's embarrassing for people to do that. And we, you know, I think we can, as Catholics, sometimes, well, you know, we have this natural law tradition, but many people say, oh, but that's just religion. And, you know, in one sense, you know, they're right. And I think you right. need a variety of different ways of speaking. That's one of the things that I think a literary artist like Solzhenitsyn gives us, is that there are lots of different voices that we have to be able to hear, and we have to imitate, and we have to learn from in order to speak well to others. And I think that's one of the things that we need, is a double-barreled approach to speaking in the language of not only reason, but also faith again, and not simply saying, well, we can speak mm-hmm. in these sort of, you know, non-theological categories. Now, we don't necessarily have to make everything, you know, right. the language of scholasticism or what, you know, what have you, but we do have to speak, I think, openly in the way that Solzhenitsyn does, that there is no way out but up. And that men have forgotten God, and that's the problem. Because otherwise, I think people are not going to hear it. They're not going to see that really is the thing that they have to understand, is you know, what the nature of the human being is, a person under God, destined for liberty, a liberty that has as its target actually becoming something great.
Right, I mean, I think it's right, because ultimately, I mean, in a sense, the debate, the discussion, the question is always religious.
Yeah.
Right. There's a line, I won't get it exactly right, but there's a line from Evelyn Waugh's Brideshead Revisited, where the older brother is saying something, and he's like talking about it. He's like, why are you bringing religion into the matter? He's like, oh, I didn't know we ever left it.
Right.
Right. Meaning like it's always there. It's a question of what is the, who is the human person? And is he or she a technical cog in the capitalist state, or the socialist state, or the communist state, or whatever, or, you know, the kleptocracy state, whatever, or is the human person actually created in the image of God with a purpose beyond this world, but also a purpose of human flourishing now? So Wallace has another point, and we can kind of end here on this point. He says, and this relates, I think maybe it's a good summary of why your book matters. And Wallace says that he's talking about that this hatred, which we mentioned before, when external rights are completely unrestricted, and this is quoting Solzhenitsyn, why should one make an inner effort to restrain oneself from ignoble acts? Even more, why should one from refrain from burning hatred? And he says that hatred and self-hatred are defining marks of the modern free world. It's this visceral, corrosive thing. Yeah. And so, and it's interesting, because if you think about, he talks about fanning the flames of hatred. This is a quote of Solzhenitsyn. Fanning the flames of hatred is becoming the mark of today's free society. So if we look at, say, social media, politics, media, we're constantly fanning the flames of hatred. We're scapegoating other people, right? And then there's self-hatred, and we see like depression, despair, yeah. suicide. And so what Wallace says is, here's the irony. The free West and the totalitarian East, according to Solzhenitsyn, suffer from the same malady, this hatred. The more personal freedom, the greater prosperity and abundance, this is Solzhenitsyn, the more vehement, paradoxically, does the blind hatred become. Here again, we witness the single outcome of a worldwide process, with East and West yielding to the same results. And once again, for the same reason, men have forgotten God.
Yeah.
That's very powerful, like, because it actually goes to the point, like, so both of us are Catholics, you're a theologian, I'm a philosopher, and in some ways we're embarrassed, like, well, okay, let's talk about it. I'll make the philosophical argument with you. But Solzhenitsyn gets to the point, you've forgotten God. And then that matters, because that is the source of the political malady right. that we're in.
Well, I mean, you know, if you forget God, then what image are humans made in, right? Well, they're not made, you know, they're either just matter, or they appear to us quite often as demonic, because they have these wills and they're different from ours. And thus the only way we can deal with them is to somehow destroy them, or, you know, shut them up. Whereas if you think that they're in the image of God, no matter how angry you are, you suddenly realize, my goodness, they might have something to reveal to me. Mm-hmm. You know, this is, again, this is all over Solzhenitsyn's writings, his memoirs, the first volume, The Oak and the Calf, which, you know, is the beginning of his writing career. It's filled with all of these figures as he's writing underground and these people who are spying on him. And what's remarkable is that, you know, he can be, well, he can be harsh with them at times in his judgments on them, but there's ultimately a sympathy for them. And there's ultimately an eye of compassion, even for those who are, you know, as bad as can be, or who are kind of traitors to him. And I don't think that you can have that. We have, you know, we have this endless pursuit of justice in the free West. And we have this, you know, everything has to be about justice, whether it's social or otherwise. But we have almost no capacity for forgiveness or even understanding.
Right. Yeah, I think this is, I think there's a whole other question. But I think one of the modern problems is we don't have forgiveness, repentance, absolution.
Right.
And this is an issue. I think it's just kind of, we kind of end here, but it's kind of striking because, you know, if you look around, what are the problems? It's always interesting to read Solzhenitsyn because he points you to think of new things. And like the, one of the problems we have today is hatred. Like if you think about what's modern America's problem, I don't know if I'd first say hatred, but when Solzhenitsyn says it, you begin to think, well, even like the ideas of justice, I mean, because there's no forgiveness and redemption, there's no sympathy for the other.
Right.
Justice means crushing your opponent, right? It's like this kind of power versus power.
Yeah.
And while this quote, Solzhenitsyn, I think it's this Templeton address, where he says that all, this is Solzhenitsyn, a quote, all attempts to find a way out of the plight of today's world are fruitless unless we redirect our consciousness in repentance to the creator of all. Without this, no exit will be illumined, and we shall seek it in vain. The resources we have set aside for ourselves are too impoverished for the task. We must first recognize the horror perpetuated not by some outside force, not by class or national enemy, but within each of us individually. Our entire earthly existence is but a transitional stage in the movement towards something higher. The combined vision of all the thinkers of the Enlightenment amounts to nothing. That's in a sense the fundamental question. We want to find, this is in a sense the disease of Rousseau and others. We want to find the solution to the problems of evil, sin, suffering, and death through a technical solution because the cause is outside. And he says, absolutely not. That's the error of the Enlightenment. The error of the Enlightenment is this notion of human perfectibility and a technocratic solution. And so it's really like, it's not, Solzhenitsyn is in a sense, not just a philosopher of the 20th century gulags. He is, in a sense, I think, and with Ratzinger, and there's a lot of them, but I'm thinking Ratzinger, especially in the 20th century, C.S. Lewis as well.
Yeah.
It's saying we have made large errors. And it's not a rejection of the liberal tradition and the political liberty and everything. It's that the Enlightenment has reduced everything to a technocratic element and that thinks we can solve the problem of evil by the outside. He says, no, absolutely not. Evil runs through the human heart. And the solution is to repent to the creator of all, which is not like, I don't know, it's not going to get, I don't think it's going to get a lot of hits on social media.
Right. Well, I mean, but that's his thing. Repentance and self-limitation are the steps forward. Right? Like, wait, what? I don't want to limit myself? Come on.
And I think that's actually, by the way, just to circle back, that's actually the problem with a lot of the modern utilitarian Stoics. There's not self-limitation.
Right.
And there's not repentance. So you don't put yourself precisely in exactly where you are in being. And because of that, it's not prudent because you don't know where you are. Right. I mean, these are, you know, I don't know. I mean, we're talking here. We can end. But I do think like this is to meditate on these points.
Yeah.
I think are very important. And I think this is why Solzhenitsyn matters. And every time I read Solzhenitsyn, I come away both inspired, but also convicted.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that's part of it is that, I mean, you know, I'm not saying you're wrong to say he's a kind of great philosopher and thinker, but I think what makes him worthwhile is the literary artistry with which he, you know, draws these pictures on the page and outlines these things and speaks in these different voices. And, and it adds something to it when you not only say this stuff, but then you have the picture of the old woman who stands up to the to the investigators or to the, you know, to the various figures, either fictional or real, that he shows in their different responses to their situations. When I teach One Day in the Life of Ivan Denisovich in a class called, you know, The Search for Happiness in the Catholic Tradition, you know, there are these various characters, and I always, they kind of represent in a certain way various kinds of responses to being in a prison camp, to being under duress. And they're all very recognizably human. Mm-hmm. I often ask the students to write an essay about, if you were going to be one of these, you know, if you were in the gulag, which character would you be closest to? Because Solzhenitsyn draws them, even in a short novella, in such a mm-hmm. way that, you know, you're like, oh, I know this guy. Yeah, that's who I would be. Or I would be like him a little bit, but be like this other, you know. And I think it's incredibly powerful for students to think about that. And it's mm-hmm. powerful for you and me. Like, who would I be if I were in this camp?
Right.
Who am I now in my own situation?
That's right. Yeah. Because we, you know, I've talked about this before. We think we'd be the great hero. But I mean, how often do we just kind of capitulate?
Yeah.
Not just because we're being polite, but like capitulate because we don't really want the hassle. Well, that means we're habituating ourselves to capitulate.
Right.
When the real challenge comes, and to not tell the truth, not tell the truth in love. And I think that's another element. Like, Solzhenitsyn is trying his best to tell the truth in love.
Yeah.
Which goes to your point about that it's not a hatred or a destruction of the other. It's to tell the truth in love.
Sure.
So, Dave, thanks for your time. This is great. I learned a lot. Appreciate the time. Appreciate the book that you edited. And I know you're working on a number of projects on Newman. So yeah. Maybe we can have you come back to talk about Newman and some of your work on education.
Yeah. I think it's not unconnected to Solzhenitsyn, because it's, you know, education is the formation of a real human being is, I think, you know, that's also what's lacking.
why don't we end to just give us maybe a little quick summary about why you think that's important, and then what you would say in doing this work and reading Solzhenitsyn and the Russian writers so carefully, what's maybe the thing that you took away that really struck you or maybe has impacted you the most deeply?
Yeah. Well, so for the project that's coming up, I'm working with a former student and a current student on putting together some of Newman's practical writings. John Henry Newman, many people have heard of his great idea of a university, which is about the formation, basically the formation of an educated mind. But what they don't often see is how he approached the practical questions when he was the rector of the Catholic University of Ireland in the 1850s. So we're putting together many of his practical documents about what his university looked like and the real issues that were involved. Like I say, I think that's connected because for Solzhenitsyn, again, it's about the formation of community, the real community in which people act on their liberty. The same thing goes for Newman's idea of a university. He thought much more about, you know, where the students would live and how they would spend their days and what kind of recreation they would have and what kind of ascetical life they would have than just simply about texts and methods of instruction and things like that.
Yeah, I think human, for just to quickly, like, I think that point about education properly is human formation.
Right.
And I'm not an expert in Newman, although I do have a son named John Henry after Newman. But my father-in-law, may he rest in peace, my father-in-law wrote his doctoral dissertation years ago on Newman and Ex Corde Ecclesiae, which I read a couple times, you know, and I read. And it's actually really, it's interesting. I learned a lot about how Newman's idea of the university and this idea, but this idea of human formation, I think, is really a deep connection between Solzhenitsyn and Newman and other writers, that education without the soul, without the formation, without the virtues, it can create not just a soulless technocrat, but a dangerous one.
Yeah. I mean, and this actually then connects to one of the things that I've been thinking about with regard to Solzhenitsyn and as well as some of the other Russian writers, is that value of concentration and the capacity to concentrate on the truth and to be formed by it. And I think that's something that's really present. I mean, one of the essays in our book by some people will know the Russian novelist Eugene Vodolazkin, the author of Loras. But one of his essays in there is on an age of concentration. And he saw us as leaving the modern age. And what are we going to be like? Well, we're going to be something a little bit more like the Middle Ages if we're lucky, not just going to descend into postmodern nihilism and anarchy. But we're going to be an age that then thinks about how to concentrate. And Solzhenitsyn himself likes to talk about that you know, in some of his writings about, well, what do we really need to do? What is, if there's a practical life hack from Solzhenitsyn, which as we've said is not a good way to think about it, but if there's a practical way that comes out of this vision of the human person, what might it involve? And one of the things that he talks about is having a kind of shutoff valve to the constant stream of news and entertainment and all these things that come in, and being able to actually take in the things that we take in and actually digest them. And again, that's, I think, deeply connected. We have to, education really is about forming a person to have a mind that can digest what we take in and actually use it in developing what we're meant to be.
Yeah, I think that's that could be a whole podcast on thinking about concentration. I mean, I'm critical a bit of the kind of life hack stoic, yeah, Tim Ferriss stuff. But I do think they're also trying to get to this concentration. I think there's errors, which we could talk about later. But
yeah,
I think that trying to get, like, okay, we have to shut things off. You know, Cal Newport,
yeah,
has written a book called Digital Minimalism, another book called Deep Work.
Right.
Which is really good.
Nicholas Carr's Into the Shallows. I mean, there's all sorts of,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, you have to. And
it's all true. We do need to have that shutoff valve. It's just, it can't just be a life hack. It has to come out of a real attention to truth. And ultimately an attention, I think, to God.
Yeah, you know, I think that's exactly right. And I found by Joseph Pieper, who's one of my favorite contemporary 20th century philosophers. Pieper has this line, which is related to exactly what you're saying, and you may know it. But he says, quote, "Fundamental truths must be pondered anew, lest they lose their fruitfulness. In this lies the significance of meditation, that truth may not cease to be present and effective in the active life." And I think that's like, so that what you're saying is that,
yeah,
you're not just meditating for the sake of meditating. You need to ponder fundamental truths so that they don't cease to be present and effective in the active life. And that seems to me to align directly with Solzhenitsyn's concerns.
That's right. That's right. You have to have that attention to these old things, and you have to sort of reponder them again and again, because in each new situation, right, prudence is going to dictate that what they mean is different. But if you're not actually thinking about them, then you're not going to be able to think well about what is demanded of you in the present moment.
Right. And that's hard. So that's the life hack of this
right,
podcast, which is the, like, really, really hard. So Dave, thanks again for joining the Moral Imagination podcast. I'll put links to where people can find your work at Logos and other things and this book on the moralimagination.com website. And I hope we can have you back to discuss Newman and I'd also silence. I mean, we want to talk about why silence matters. So thanks, Dave.
Thank you. I'd be delighted.